course. You probably know who I am off of a different channel that I'm most active on, but I figure I need to post on this one just to maybe revive it, since it has, last I checked, bit over 600 subs on YouTube, and I figure might as well do these, like, three-month, like, vlog intervals. So, first of all, I would like to address some questions that I've personally been asked while wearing this. Yes, this is the official uniform. Just need to turn it around. Just wear this like so. Of course, I will have a short sleeve shirt on over this before I put this on. And of course, we have our name badge. Of course, I like to stick mine. Of course, there's a little hole, like, right here, that is best suited to clip the name badge on. Now, having the vest zipped up is well preferred. That way it looks more professional, more neat and such. But not like everybody in the company has to wear a vest like this. Management, like, they still gotta wear their badges, but they can come in, like, in a professional attire, and they have the yellow card that goes under their badge. Like, the stuff that's being covered by the name badge, I believe it's just like a blank slate that's done on purpose by corporate or whatever part of the, well, company. I know it's like someone in corporate who makes the badges and, like, ships them out to the stores. Of course, I do want to go over, like, these codes here. Like, of course, it's not shown properly, but of course, there's at least one code that is right now not applicable to my Walmart, but they keep it on there because it's not specifically tailored. Like, each badge is not specifically tailored to the store, depending on the location. Because Walmart is an international company. Now, the code white is simply an injury, like if a dislocated shoulder happens or if there's blood coming out. Or let's say someone like punches me right in the face and it breaks my nose. Like, if the associate can't like fully recover from the harm that was done to them physically, it's a code white. The associate who is nearest to the action will have to call code white. It practically takes the associate who was injured, and a part of code white, out of work for an undetermined amount of time. Then we have code blue, which is a bomb threat. It's basically a extremely rare occasion that a code blue gets called, but corporate still keeps it up and active in case a bomb threat does happen. And I'm gonna say this again, Walmart is an international company, as it's not just based in the United States or not just based in Canada. There are stores in the UK, in Australia, just to name a few. Then there's code red, which is a fire. And of course, the Walmart I work at, we're right next to the freeway. So if, let's say, a passenger on the driveway, not driveway, on the freeway, like, throws a lit cigarette onto, like, the grass area that's between the freeway and my Walmart, and it spreads to the store itself, then it's an automatic code red. All the customers, all the associates, everyone has to leave to a safe area, dial 911, or if it's like at a UK store, it's 999 or 999. We give the 911 operator the info, and boom. The whole store gets shut down until the firefighters get that fire contained. Then we have a code black, which for my store, it's Like, well, it's like so rare that a code black would happen, like a tornado would happen, because my Walmart is not in a usual tornado path. But it could still happen at Walmart. If a tornado comes through my Walmart, I'm practically out of the job. Now we have a code Adam, which is probably like one of the most common codes to give out. That's basically when a child is separated from their parent or legal guardian who happens to be in the store at the time. Let's say my youngest nephew, like, runs to the other side of the store, and I'm the one that has to supervise him. If I have no idea where he is, I go to my supervisor or a member of management, like, hey, we have a code Adam. It is my nephew, and this is what he looks like. And well, they'll call it over to PA, the public address system. Of course, it will take priority over the Walmart radio broadcast at that time. Then we have a code orange, which I've personally seen. It's basically when, like, let's say you got like the liquid Clorox spray. You accidentally bump it off the shelf and the lid pops open and spills all over the aisle. I call a code orange to my supervisor and get it like settled. There's a powder that's used, like put onto the floor of where the spill is. And while one associate is going to get that powder, that spill has to be guarded by an associate. That way, the customer is like, don't come into contact with it. And then we have a code brown. It's like less threatening than a code blue, but it could easily, at the minimalist, turn into a code white. A code brown is practically like if there's a fight going on, or if, like, someone brings like a gun or a knife with an intent to harm someone, it's an automatic code brown. Tell a supervisor or member of management, and then if it's a supervisor who's being informed, they go and tell management, and then management handles it from there. Now, when I clock in, I do it like this. Of course, I'll do it like this, so it's like from your point of view. I swipe it, and then I press the top left button, which is for clock in. After I push that button, like I am on the clock. And I have to go to personnel, which is in the back of the room in the associates only area, hence why I need to have the badge, because this is required for entry into the associates only area. And then, since we're in the pandemic right now, have to wear face covering like so, and then we hold a badge like this, so that way an authorized health screener, which is usually someone in management, can scan this barcode and then they ask if I have any symptoms. If it's like all nose, then we're good to go. Of course, we're good to go work. And of course, we still have to have the face covering on because we're out on the floor with contact. We're in constant communication with each other, and we're in contact with you, the customers. When we're stocking the shelves, we use a clever exchange knife. And of course, we like get the box open. Open it up. Of course, that is after we scan the barcode. Sometimes it's on the label that's provided by corporate or just distribution, mainly corporate. And then, of course, there are two ways to know if the item that is being scanned can be fully shelved. Number one is the easy one. Scan it, we hear a beep, we know it can be fully stocked. It just doesn't give us more information, like how many like units of the product are currently on the shelf, which is something my Walmart would need. So if there's like more units of the product in the box than what's on the shelf, just put up however many we can, and then on the top shelf where it says to request assistance from an associate, we put the excess on top. Now, I've personally seen customers like reach up to the associate shelf and grab stuff off of there instead of doing the right thing by going to a blue vest or a yellow vest Walmart associate and saying like, "Hey, could you get this item down for me?" Like that is like a big pet peeve for me because sure, the customers do not have access to the carts that the associates do. And of course, the carts I'm talking about are the top stock cart, the rocket cart, and the L cart. The top stock cart has like three like levels, a pair of handlebars at the back, and a three-step ladder that folds up. A rocket cart has the little pull rod, it's like a cage. It has a small level and a small like horizontal level and a big horizontal level, and it has like the small little space to like put like the cardboard in. And then there's the L cart. It's literally like a big letter L. Like, this is actually like what it looks like. The L cart is best used for the paper aisles, which in my store would be aisles A22 and A23 towards the back of the store. The top stock cart is the one I prefer to use, and if I can get a hand on it, if I can get my hands on one, that makes it good because I don't have to like go on my toes and reach up just to get the excess unit of the product onto the associate shelf. I just have to align the top stock cart right next to where I can see an open spot on the shelf on the associate level. Flip the little trigger to release the step ladder, and of course, I have to grab onto the handlebars for safety issues. And then go 1, 2, 3. Of course, the first two steps are the small steps, and then the third one is the big one. And of course, I leave like the excess of all the excess units of the product that all in the box. And then I put it like on the top level of the top stock cart. That's like, of course, I make sure that it's closest to me. And then we have to put it to where the barcode is like facing out. Let's just say it's a can of Dr. Pepper, for example, and I'm not sponsored by them. And this is an excess unit of that product. And this is the shelf. I have to make sure it is out with barcode showing. The barcode does not even have to be lined up to where the numbers touch the actual shelf, as long as the barcode is showing. Like, in towards the aisle, it's good to go. And of course, I'm practically like work hard to get the products out onto the shelf so that you can buy them and take them home after you pay for them. And now for the summary of my experience at the 3 month mark of working for Walmart since I started on June the 29th, 2020. It's been like an up and down kind of process. There's been some days where I feel like less efficient because I've been drinking like Dr. Pepper beforehand and I forget to get water or Powerades. I purchased using my own money because at time of recording I've not received my employee or associate discount card. And there have been some points where I wanted to, like, resign, but then I remember in the back of my head that I still have a goal to meet, and that goal is to take a vacation from San Jose, California, USA, to Brisbane, Queensland, Australia, as early as 2025. Of course, I'm just making sure my computer like knows I'm like doing stuff so it doesn't like go to sleep on me. Now, like, there are like certain customers who I never even bothered to get the name of because it's not part of my job to get that info from them. Like, they ask like questions that, well, really get to me. Like one of the, well, most frequent questions I've personally been asked is like, do you have more of this in the back? As a stocker for Walmart, I can personally say that, well, I see the products. Like, come in boxes, even some that are like I can actually see them, but they're plastic wrapped. By the company who actually makes them. So, like, I see the products like first, and that's just like from the store level up to when it's actually on the shelf. So, whatever is out of the back room and onto the shelves is basically what we have available. If you want like a product that's made by a certain brand and my store somehow doesn't have it available. And of course, I say this like literally right to the customer who asks for a particular product. You buy it through the Walmart app or at walmart.com. Of course, the Walmart app is free to download on Google Play and Apple's Play Store and other app stores that are available to have Walmart on there. Of course, it's just the Apple App Store and Google Play. You register a Walmart.com account, which is free, and of course, the account has to be verified. And then you have like two options. You could either have the product delivered to your house free of charge, or you could have the product delivered to the closest Walmart store. And you can just walk into that Walmart, go to the pickup area. Of course, each Walmart has a different spot for the pickup area. My Walmart's pickup area is like literally at the front of the store. You just walk in and boom, it's on your right. Of course, my Walmart's like a small Walmart. It's not a neighborhood market, otherwise this would be a green vest. And it's not a super center, which I have to bring this up like later on in the video. And of course, there's also the grocery pickup. If the product you want is a grocery item, the minimal you'll have to spend is $30 in order to get the free grocery pickup. There are six spaces towards the front of the store, like right by the little entry area. Just pull up to one of those six spaces. It's a 2x3. It's like 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. It's like this. You pull up in one of the six designated orange spaces, and through the app, you hit check in, and then we, as Walmart associates, will be notified like you've arrived to pick up your order. There will be associates wearing yellow vests, and of course, at time of recording, it is the pandemic, so we'll also be wearing face coverings, sort of like this. Sometimes we'll even wear the ones that are Walmart branded. Those are not available to the public, those are only available to Walmart associates. And if I were to say that, oh, I'm just not going to continue onward. It's just like a Walmart associate exclusive. And we will bring them out to your car or truck or whatever vehicle, as long as it can fit in the space. We will kindly ask you to pop the trunk of your vehicle. That way we don't come into contact with you and we can load your order like into your vehicle and then you can just be on your way. And of course, The next question is, where is this item? That's where the Walmart app comes into play. Like, we can give you like the aisle number of where it's at if we personally have seen it like very frequently. But if it's something we don't see on a regular basis, depending on who you ask, we just tell you like the general section of the store where it is located at. And we do this to help you find the items so you can, well, find it, put in your shopping cart, head to the registers with it, and pay for it. But if you have the Walmart app and a Walmart.com account, of course that part is optional because you do not, well, you are not required to have a Walmart.com account in order to look up where the item is located. Of course, you don't even have to be in a store to like look up where it is, but it is preferred is preferred that you be in the store when you launch the Walmart app. Of course, when you walk into the store, I recommend that you give the Walmart app like, let's say, around 5 minutes from the time you set foot in the store. That way it can like update the GPS from your phone and like when you launch the Walmart app, the blue border, like this blue border that says Walmart.com with this little logo on the top left of the app, it will magically turn yellow, like this yellow. And in black, it'll say store assistant. The virtual Sam Walton, because the real one is no longer with us, basically the Ask Sam feature, which is like secretly built in to the Walmart app and has been kept into the app since it first launched, like virtual Sam will like help you find the item in the store. So when you search for an item and put in the keywords, like let's say you're looking for Lysol disinfecting wipes, you type in those keywords into the search bar and hit search. It'll give you two options. Option one is Walmart.com, and option two is at your store. When you're inside the store, on the search results, tap the second option, and it will show you like a geographical map of where that search result is located. But you'll have to tap on the search result to see if there's any of that product in stock. Now, I bring up the disinfecting wipes is because that is right now, at time of recording, one of the most popular items that customers buy. And because we're in a pandemic, we are limiting it to one unit or like one of the product per customer. So if you want to stock up on disinfecting wipes, I personally recommend that you bring like a big group of like friends and family members who live with you or may not live with you, just like a big group of people in your group, well, in your basically bring a group of people you know into the store, and each person, like literally each person, grabs one of the product. That way, you can abide by the one per person policy and you can stock up at the same time. That is, if the plan is to stock up for one particular home. Because, well, if we see like one person with two or more of the same product, we have to like take it out of the cart. We'll take all but one of that product out of the cart. And inform the customer, like, hey, it's only one per customer. Of course, I personally hate to do that. But it's basically out of my control on if I can, like, make exceptions to the policy or not. And let's see. The last question I get, and of course, this does not like apply. Actually, no, it's the second to last question that I get. But this one does not apply to just Walmart, it applies to like everywhere. Do you work here? Oh my God. I mean, I don't know. Do I have a company name badge with my name on it? Do I have a company uniform on? Do I have a store use only scanner to scan boxes or scan the products? Do I have a knife to open said box or cut open the plastic to get the product out? And do you see me like stocking the shelves with the products that you want to buy? If all those questions have been answered yes, then yes, I do work here. It's like, I'm pretty sure Walmart does not like publicly sell these vests to everybody. And of course, this one is my favorite question. Do you have a key for this cabinet? Of course, the second part is like, could you call somebody, let's say on a radio, who has a key for it? Let's go with the radio one first. Not every single Walmart associate you see in the store has a radio, an earpiece, and a wire. Like a small, like Bluetooth-esque mic on their uniform. If that was the case, you'd see every Walmart employee in the store with a radio and a microphone. Sort of like this, like on them, and if the name badges are not visible, you couldn't tell who was a member of management. Who's a supervisor and who's just a regular associate? So, only supervisors and members of management have radios and keys to cabinets. The cabinets at my Walmart are the liquor cabinet, the infant cabinet, the chemical cabinet, and the HBA or pain, health, beauty cabinets. Of course, there's like, let's say close to 6 to 12 cabinets just in the pharmacy area alone. Of course, I will, actually, no, let me see. There's like 1, 2, 3, 4 cabinets in the beauty. And there's a razor cabinet. There's like 2 or 3 pain medicine cabinets. So let's just say around a dozen cabinets just for the pharmacy area alone. Then there's the infant cabinet, which is a big 3-section cabinet. So that's like 'course, then there's a alcohol or liquor cabinet. There's a chemical cabinet, and there's a pets cabinet. So let's just say there's 1.5 dozen cabinets that are locked up specifically so the customers can't like grab the products that are locked in there and stock up on those. To be more specific, for the liquor cabinet, whoever has the key at that moment could be a supervisor, could be a member of management, or an associate that's entrusted by a supervisor or a member of management with a key to go over to the liquor cabinet. We open it up, we ask the customer like what they want while we're opening it. We grab whatever the customer wants. We lock it, and then we inform the customer that it will be at register one, which is the hub register to pick up like reserved liquor, because we cannot trust any customer to keep the liquor in their car, because they could have like a little corkscrew like bottle opener. You could open up the liquor and drink it without paying for it, which is a form of shoplifting. So let's just say I'm working the liquor and snacks aisle, which for my store would be aisles A18 and A19. I'm given the keys to the liquor cabinet by my supervisor, whom I shall not name, because I have two supervisors. Of course, each one is a separate ethnicity, but I'm not going to go into that any further. So I have a key to the liquor cabinet. Customer asks me like, hey, do you have a key for this cabinet? I'm like, oh yeah, I do. I pull out the key, ask the customer like, hey, what do you want me to get out for you? And they tell me what they want. I open the appropriate door, grab the product, close it, and then put the keys back. I tell the customer like, hey, this is going to be placed at register one. Be sure to pick it up when you're checking out. It's going to be at register one. And if there's a fellow associate with me in the aisle, they could be working that aisle with me, or they could be someone who's like strolling by or nearby. And I was assigned to work the snacks and liquor aisle. I say to them like, one of two things. One, like, bring this up to register one for this customer, and then I hand it off to them. They go off to register one to leave it with the cashier, and then they go back to whatever they're doing. Or two, like, I'm gonna bring this to register one, and they'd be like, okay, thanks for informing me. Of course, if it's a supervisor or a member of management who I tell, like, they say like, thanks for letting me know. And I go up and put in register one, because the supervisor or the member of management who I speak to about the liquor will be informed and will know that I'm temporarily stopping my assigned task to bring a high value item up to register one. And of course, I like see, like, I Fucking can't believe I forgot there was a battery cabinet. That's because there's at the registers, and I like only see that cabinet when I'm like leaving or heading to the break room to either clock in, clock out for lunch, clock in from lunch, or to clock out in general. So I don't see that. So let's just say we got like around two dozen or 24 cabinets in total. And of course, I cannot like ask for ID to make sure that the person is of at least 21 years of age. That is the legal drinking age in the United States and in Canada. Course, to see if they are old enough to purchase the item. Our registers, however, have that in place, especially at register one. Because when the cashier rings up the liquor or any other alcohol-based product, Virtual Sam will inform the cashier to enter the date of birth of the customer and to request ID. Now, at time of recording, we are only accepting and approving alcohol product purchases from customers who are born on September 26th, 2000. Oh. 1999 or earlier. Of course, the date could be different from when you're watching this. So, let me clarify this again. At time of recording, the only people who are eligible to purchase alcohol type products from my Walmart or any other Walmart in the United States and in Canada, they have to be born on September 26th, 1999 or earlier. Because if you're born on September 27th, 1999 or later, sorry bub, we can't sell you the alcohol. So, in my 3 month period of working for Walmart, I would say it's a 9 out of 10 because, well, one, if a customer gets irate with me, I have to just let it go. Not let the customer's rude comments mess with my focus on the task at hand. And if a member of management or my supervisor happens to stroll by and I remember to inform them, I go and inform them, like, hey, this is what customer B or customer A, let's just say it's a John Doe or a Jane Smith. I tell the member of management or my supervisor or a supervisor, like, hey, Jane Smith did XYZ towards me earlier. They're wearing this, that, and this is how it happened. Could you keep an eye on them? And they say to me that they're thankful for informing them and that they'll keep an eye on them. Of course, I have a little story of a recent shift actually involved a rude customer who had her child in tow. And of course, the child was hanging on the back side of the shopping cart, and she was like doing her job as a parent to hold on to him. Of course, I see her do it. I see the child like hanging on the back of the shopping cart. And I kindly inform the mother of the child that her son was unsafe hanging on the back of the cart. She comes around to me and tells me off. Basically telling me, "Don't tell me what to do. I'm hanging on to him. You just get back to work. You're being paid to work, blah, blah, blah." Like, at that moment, I just wanted to, like, stop my task for a bit just to tell that rude customer, like, sort of the following. Like, "Excuse me, but I am working. I am working hard to make sure you have a safe and worry-free time while you're shopping in this store. If I see that your child is unsafe on a shopping cart that my company is letting you use, and your child gets hurt, I'm not liable for your child's injuries. So you need to shut your mouth, finish your shopping trip, head up to the registers, pay for stuff you have in your cart, and leave. Because I don't want to see you again." But I couldn't because of my role. So what I did is just blew it off, went back to my assigned task of stocking the products onto the shelves, and thankfully it hadn't like faded out of my memory yet, as a support manager so happened to be strolling into the aisle I was working at. And of course, I believe he did handle it. And I said, like, "Hey," of course, I'm not going to give out the name of the support manager that I spoke to. I'm just going to say, like, "Hey, SM." And of course, I informed him about the situation that I encountered earlier, and I basically said, like, "Could you keep an eye on, like, could you keep an eye on her?" And he said, like, "Okay." Now, the reason why I'm not giving out names of management or my supervisors is that there would be some colorful language I would use if I did name them, especially if I went as to reveal their ethnicities or race, because I want to protect their privacy and I want to protect my job. Because I want to continue like swiping this day in and day out per shift day. I want to continue like providing the products that you as the customer want to buy. So, with that said, you can subscribe by clicking the subscribe button down below or clicking my face, which is somewhere on the screen. You can check out featured videos and the featured channel. And I will see you in 3 months for the 6 month report.